cookout here at the church this year as opposed to a picnic off-site. September 12th is a Tuesday night, and as time approaches, we'll give more details about the time of that. But we wanted to go ahead and give you a heads up to mark the date. It is, again, a Tuesday evening, and we look forward to another opportunity for fellowship and food as a congregation. This morning, we are privileged to welcome Jane Hogan into our church membership. She met with the session this past month, and this morning will be the time that she comes to stand before us. So later in the service, we hope that you'll take time to come and welcome her as the service concludes. She will be asked to stay here in front to say hello to everybody. But it's certainly a joy to have her coming into the church family and having that opportunity today. With those announcements being made, are there any additional calendar concerns or announcements to share as a church family?
Can I say something about Towers of Blessing?
Yes, please do.
Okay. This month, we're working with Amanda Goforth, who works with the CU International Students. And our church and homemakers are putting together bags. They'll be in this bag, in these kinds of bags. and we have, we're going to do snacks. Okay? So, you know, NABs, breakfast bars, granola bars, candy, anything that will fit in here. And if you end up bringing something that won't fit in here, don't worry, we'll give it to them anyway, because they can use it. They have get-togethers, and they'll have snack times then, and so we'll get whatever you give us to them. Thank you.
And one of the things that has developed over time is evidently this morning there is a phantom buzz in our heating system, or our cooling system, I should say. So I think I know the answer to this, but we could get rid of the buzz by turning off the air, or we could deal with the frustration. And I thought that would be the answer, but I just wanted to present it to be, you know, democratic in our process. So may we, through the frustrations and maybe just the dealing with the what the buzz sound causes in our minds, just dealing with that frustration, may we find this morning as a morning to see through the distractions, to get through to the meat of the message of what we have before us today as we turn to God in worship, gathered around God's word in song and in praise. May we enter into this time of worship as we prepare our hearts and minds, as the music of the prelude helps us in doing so. Thank you. Come, let us worship the Lord. Come to Jesus, all you who have suffered a beatdown this week. Come to Jesus, all you who have experienced turmoil this week. Come to Jesus, all you who are tired of conflict all around. Come to Jesus, all you who are weary of reports, senseless thoughts. Jesus said, I will give you rest. I'll bring you relief. I'll provide your deliverance. I'll make a way. And Jesus will give us wonderful rest. Let us come and worship the Lord. May we stand and lift our voices in song to hymn number 485, To God Be the Glory.
Thank you.
still and hear your words to us, words that call us to be people of praise and people of faith. This we ask in your holy, mighty, matchless name. Amen and amen. In the 45th Psalm, beginning in the 10th verse, we hear these words of the psalmist urging and reminding us of the worthiness of God's praise. Hear, O daughter, consider and incline your ear. Forget your people and your father's house, and the king will desire your beauty, since he is your Lord. Bow to him. Daughter Tyre will seek your favor with gifts, the richest of people with all kinds of wealth. The princess is decked in her chamber with gold and woven robes. In many-colored robes she is led to the king. Behind her, the virgins, her companions, follow. With joy and gladness, they are led along as they enter the palace of the king. In the palace, or in the place of ancestors, you, O king, shall have sons. You will make them princes in the earth. I will cause your name to be celebrated in all generations. Therefore, the peoples will praise you forever and ever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now, as we come standing before the praiseworthy God, we come also acknowledging some of the challenges we face as human beings as we stand before the God worthy of praise. Speaking of our own human conditions, Paul writes of these conflicting issues that we deal with as humans, writing in Romans chapter 7 these challenging words: I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing that I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good, but in fact it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that the good does not dwell within me, that is, in my flesh. For the desire to do the good lies close at hand, but not the ability. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close to hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in all my members. Wretched person that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Friends, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for you are our rock and you are our Redeemer. Amen and amen. It was 1937 when Disney adapted the story to film, but it's a fairy tale that goes back to 1812, written in Germany, published by the Brothers Grimm. Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs is the fairy tale I'm talking about, and we know that it is since 1812 and since 1937 been told and retold in various forms many, many, many times over. So it's probably hard to find anyone inhabiting the planet Earth that has any sort of connection to technology in the world. Hard to find anyone who would be unaware of what the evil queen does and her way of doing things. In consulting with this very special mirror, this magic mirror that she goes to time and time again. And we are all familiar that the queen in the story stands before the mirror and asks this mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of them all, right? We know that conversation, and we know the rest of that fairy tale story. Mirrors. They seem to be a part of our world, a permanent fixture in many places that we look, everywhere. Sevier Rivers. That was going to be the conversation Michelle was going to share with the children and the children's home. These funhouse mirrors that distort our bodies incredibly, sometimes in very unflattering fashions. There are, of course, the side view and rear view mirrors of our vehicles, as well as the visor mirrors. As I think of visor mirrors, my mind dials back to when my sister turned 16 and learned that she could put on all of her makeup, lipstick, blush, eyeliner, mascara, and stoplights on the way to Henry Clay High School, much to the chagrin of my father, who was not quite a fan of that safety factor. But anyway, there are mirrors everywhere we are. They're in our cars, they're in our pockets, in our purses, and even magnifying mirrors that help us to see things more up close. I guess, you know, in my world, that's the sort of thing that's used for trimming ear hair and plugging eyebrows, but that's another story. We find mirrors in corners of malls and clothing shops, hotel rooms, and restaurant bathrooms. And I think it's fair to say that we are a society that is a fan of being able to see ourselves. We like mirrors. But in biblical days, mirrors were not what they are today. They were imperfect devices. And in his first letter to the Corinthian church, the Apostle Paul writes this phrase that now we see in a mirror dimly. Now we see in a mirror dimly. The picture we have of ourselves is not a clear picture. And that wording is actually from the New Revised Standard Version, the version of the Bible that we have in our pews. But it, or something similar to it, is how most English translations of the Bible render this verse. But there's one of those language barriers, isn't the right word, but one of those language idiosyncrasies about the Greek that we translate dimly or darkly in the King James Version, because the word that we get that definition from, or that translation from, actually could more correctly be translated as enigma. So the NRSV has a footnote that allows, instead of writing dimly, the Greek could be translated here, for now we see in a mirror, in a riddle. The person we see when we look in the mirror is an enigma. Perhaps J.D. Phillips, who's a New Testament commentator, writes in the New Testament in modern English. He captures the sense of the Greek here when he renders his description or his translation of Paul's comment as, at present we are people looking at puzzling reflections in a mirror. Do you ever feel that way about your view of yourself? I puzzle myself when I consider who I am. Maybe you think we don't have that problem today, since our mirrors, our literal mirrors, are so much better than the primitive ones in the first century. And as time goes, our modern mirrors are getting better and better and better. There's a product that developed several years ago called True Mirror, and it's a patented name. But it's a patented name for a type of mirror that reflects what you truly look like to others. So it doesn't have that mirror image issue. You get, when you look in the True Mirror, an authentic view of yourself. So if you hold up a book, as you look in the True Mirror, you're going to read the letters as they appear, not flip-flopped. As you look at yourself, if you hold out your right hand goes out. You're not going to see your right hand as your left hand. You know what I'm talking about with that mirror image issue. So the traditional mirror issues are done away with. And it's done by a bit of technology that changes the angles. It actually uses two mirrors and makes a seamless transition between where that's done. Anyway, it's some new technology, and if you are interested in seeing True Mirrors, they have their own website, truemirror.com. I'm not trying to advertise, I'm just saying that if you want to do a little homework a little bit later, you can see what's happened. It's not new technology, it was patented in 1887, but things have gotten much better today. But interestingly, what I want to say about True Mirror, other than trying to make a plug for them unintentionally, is that while some people are pleased when they look at the reflection in a true mirror, that life today. And in Romans 7, he defines himself, his inner being, his inner self, as an enigma, as a puzzle. He says, I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. And it's hard for me to hear Paul writing this without this old voice in my head, because I grew up as a child that watched Saturday Night Live, and Billy Crystal had this character that said, yeah, I hate it when that happens. It's a popular character. But I hear Paul saying that same thing about himself in the reality of dealing with sin in his being. I hate it when that happens. I hate it when I do the very thing I do not want to do. But still in the ensuing verses, he seems to describe this true mirror view of himself, and ironically, it's not of one image, but it is of two. One is the image of the man he wants to be, but isn't. And the other is this image of the man that he is, but doesn't want to be. It was Faust who declared in the old German legend, two souls, alas, are dwelling in my breast, and one is striving to forsake its brother. There's a war within us. And Paul is describing this in his own being. And perhaps Paul is saying that this is what the Christian life is like, that we live with this tension, tension that never gets resolved. Can you feel the tension? Was a question my seminary dean, Michael Kinneman, would ask us at various points in our classes and in our convocations. Can you feel the tension? Because there is within Christianity an ongoing tension between how things are and how things ought to be. Can you feel the tension in your own lives? Do you reflect, as Paul does, on this disjointed reality? I'd like you to consider something that the late Michael Ivins suggested. He was a Jesuit priest, and he taught and wrote widely in the field of spirituality. And in his study and in his writings, he noted that there are many people, in his words, who appear never to overcome the recurrent insurgence of their own underworld, who are nonetheless deeply Christian. And he further said that the failure in their lives seems to make a mockery of the promise that no one is tested beyond his or her strength. But in terms of dealing with these apparent failures, Ivan says there are two ways to look at it, both of which are faithful. And one is resignation to the fact that reaches out again and again to the strength offered to us and in us through the very handicaps we are asked to deal with and to bear. Call this the spirituality of patience. Patience. And the other is the attitude of intense hope that we ask for complete healing. And that we, knowing that in asking we shall not be refused. And he called this second way the spirituality of power, referring to Christ's power, Christ's limitless power. So you have this spirituality of patience and the spirituality of power. And I want to say a couple more words about each of those concepts. And the spirituality of patience means that in faithfulness to Christ, we keep working. We keep grinding it out over and over again. We do what we can do to overcome what pulls us down. What Paul refers to in verse 17 is the sin that dwells within. Who doesn't know that I'm in church? I hate it when that happens. But this spirituality, Ivan says, encourages such people to live without too much anxiety, to look at all that is positive in our lives, to believe themselves loved, to recognize that growth takes place precisely in the midst of apparent failure. And this approach promotes a gospel of healing, gradually, step by step, and over time. Not something that's instantaneous, but goes on and on in process, sometimes even over a elongated period of time. And this spirituality of patience is perhaps what Martin Luther Luther, the great church reformer, refers to by his comment, "Be a sinner and sin boldly." Sometimes that's where people stop that quote. But Martin Luther's words were, "Be a sinner and sin boldly, but believe and rejoice in Christ even more boldly." And so in context, that's usually understood to mean not to go out and purposely commit sin, but rather to believe and rejoice in Christ even more boldly despite the sin that is in our lives. Again, I can hear the voice of my seminary dean asking the student body the question, can you feel the tension? Can you feel the tension in the world that is and the world that ought to be? Can you feel the tension in your life that is and your life that ought to be? The spirituality of patience allows for a gradual becoming of who God calls us to be, despite the road bumps along the way, and despite that tension that is ever present. And then in contrast, there's this spirituality of power. And this view is one that sees Christians in relationship with Christ as therapeutic itself. That is, that a faith connection with Christ is inherently healing in and of itself, that it frees us from the clutches of persistent sins. And I think that's probably what Paul is getting at in this continuation in his discussion in the very next chapter of Romans, Romans chapter 8, where he says, "For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death." For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ has set you free from the law of sin and death. And where these two perspectives meet is that both the perspective of the spirituality of patience and the spirituality of power, they both look to Christ as the ultimate source of healing. The first, the spirituality of patience, looks for that over the long haul. And the second, the spirituality of power, looks for it in a more dramatic way all at once. So then there's this rhetorical question that Paul asks in today's text. Pardon me. Who will rescue me? Who will rescue me from this body of death? And he's setting up an answer that he already knows as he concludes with the 25th verse. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The question that he asks, he already knows the answer to. For us, as we read this, as we take this in, for us who call ourselves Christians, we who know God, well, we must learn to find within the chaos and the darkness inside ourselves the effects of this new life that Christ brings. So we should not resign ourselves to the frustration of the ongoing failure part of the cycle. But we can't just stop by declaring poor, poor, pitiful me, as those song lyrics go, or maybe considering ourselves despicable me, like the title to a recent, or fairly recent, movie title. Or we can't just keep ourselves saying again and again, like Billy Crystal on that Saturday Night Live skit, "I hate it when that happens. I hate it when that happens." With no attempt to make a change in the life we live. But at the same time, we should also realize that the challenges and the tension of everyday experience, even the failures, are not the ultimate truth about who we are and our being. Recognizing what the healing presence and ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ has already achieved in us, we can learn to discover more clearly the ways in which the work of Christ is still happening, still going on, still unfolding in our lives, and peacefully, and patiently, and even wholeheartedly, we are called to yield to that work. We are called to cry out with the psalmist, again and again, "Create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me." Despite the fact that we hate the things that we do not do the things that we want, but we do the things that spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. We are called again and again, and here reminded by the Apostle Paul, we can look into the true mirror of self-reflection and find the image looking back at us to be the image of Christ himself. For it is not we ourselves that are our righteousness. We might view ourselves as riddles and enigmas. Seeing Christ as the image that looks back at us, we can find ourselves as new and continuing creation, as works of God in progress, loved, forgiven, and free. Loved, forgiven, and free. Amen. As our worship continues, we have the opportunity to again stand and lift our voices in song, this time to the hymn, "Make Me a Captive, Lord." May we lift our voices in song. Opportunity. beginning this opportunity, I would like to encourage you to spend the opening moment of our prayer in a time of quietness, in a time of silence, time and space for you to talk with God about the matters of your heart and the concerns of your life. Let us be in prayer together. Listen to your children pray. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children pray. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Holy God, as we have paused to share with you the matters of our own hearts, we also share in our concerns as a congregation and as a church family. Bowing before you today, we lift up individuals close to our lives as we pray for Mary and Mark, for Alan and Morris, Bill, the Durhams, Bethany, Faye and Tuddy, Tandy and Jerry Sue. Lord, hear our prayers as we lift up James and Wilma, Clara, Frank, Joe David, Betty Ray and Sam and Sheila. We pray for Richard, for Kevin and Pat, LaRushka and Pam, Wendell and Nolan, Ethan, John and Raina. As we pray for Sally and Milton, Faye and Jim, Lacey, Debbie, Mary and Kathy, Joanne and Kim. Lord, in addition to these individual concerns, we pray for the collective body as a nation, as we lift up those who have been victims of gun violence that we've heard of in this past week. Lord, help us to be supportive of these individuals as well as supportive of conversations moving forward that might help move towards a more positive way of dealing with conflict in life that we experience. Ways of responding positively and having a positive impact on the life of the communities in which we live. Ways that we might inspire and encourage positive views of humans and human dignity that move us beyond violent response and move us towards a more healing and loving world in which to live. In addition, we lift our continued prayers for Ukraine and for our congregation here at Bethel First, for our Mid-Kentucky Presbytery, our ongoing prayers for our troops, we ask, as well as prayers for the Higbees and those who continue to be faithful in their service as Christian missionaries. Lord, we seek your guidance. We seek your comfort and your counsel. We seek your grace. And we bow before you, concluding with this prayer, this familiar prayer, as we pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we continue in worship, may we bring our gifts to God with this morning's presentation of tithes and offering. further the ongoing work and ministry of this, your church. May we be faithful to seek to do your will in all that we do and say, in the ways that we share, and try in our humble ways to make your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. We ask this in your holy name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. And again, please remain standing as we close our service in song. Again, we will welcome our newest member at the conclusion of the song. But Spirit of God, descend upon my heart as our closing hymn today. To you all, as we go from this day, may we go knowing that we are wrapped in the arms of God's love. God brings us into his family to be brothers and sisters in Christ, called to go into the world as the body of Christ, to do the work of the Lord, to be the hands and feet, the eyes and ears. And so may we be inspired to know that as we go, we do have this war within us, this enigma that we deal with. But as we work things out in that regard, we become more the people God calls us to be as we enable the indwelling Spirit to use us as God desires.
And so today, may we open our lives to that reality and that possibility. Not hating that we can't do the right things, but loving that we can, with God's help, be more and more the people he calls us to be, despite the conflicted nature within us. And so today, friends, go with the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace this day and forevermore. Amen and amen.